Right, so I think I got introduced already by Prajakta, but I'll still give you a quick version of my own. I'm Maninder, being in analytics for about 15 years now. I started with banking and financial sector, but then I thought I was trying to get money out of people rather than giving them experiences or making things good for them. That's why I chose to move to retail and CPG world after that. So I was with a firm called Dunhumby for about 5 years, where when I moved into retail, they are into retail analytics consulting. Was good to learn with them everything from a core R&D job to a client fronting job. I'm here representing AB InBev today. That's where I've spent last three years of my career. The good thing about AB InBev is that I'm guessing you guys don't know anything about AB InBev. Is that fair? Okay, why don't I start a little bit about, I don't know how many of you recognize this logo or why this name. It sounds a little weird, right? It's because we are a little bit weird that way. We are one of the few companies where Wikipedia has to justify how many acquisitions we have done through a dendrogram. So that's why these names, right? So AB stands for Anheuser-Busch, the company that brews Budweiser. IN stands for Interbrew, the Belgian company that was at one point the biggest beer brewing company in the world, and then it continued to merge with others. And BEV comes from AmBev, the parent company where it all started. I'll introduce my company a little bit before we get started with what I have to speak about. I hope you guys recognize these. Yeah? So this is by design. It's more important that people recognize you by not just by your name, but what you do. And I think now it's clear as to why we focus so much on just promoting what we do or what we stand for rather than our name. Fair? Just to put things in context, we are world's largest beer brewer. These are top 10 brands by their annual sales. And Budweiser, Bud Light are our products. So all the ones in color are our products. So 6 out of top 10 and 2 out of top 3 are the brands that we have on our portfolio. In total, we have about 500 beer brands and many other favorites that you'll find on our portfolio. Let's have a quick look at the
Sharing
video.
Sharing beer has brought people together for centuries. This simple act is as meaningful today as it was over 600 years ago when we first started brewing. From the very beginning, our company was built on making connections, bringing people together to make a difference. For us, that starts with brewing great beer. True masters of the craft, our brewers work closely with farmers to combine top quality barley, the choicest hops, and our taste signature yeasts to delight beer drinkers. Every bottle is one we are proud to serve. With more than 400 brands made in over 50 countries, we brew many of the world's most loved beers and have a beer to suit every occasion. We continue to lead the way, pushing the boundaries with new tastes and experiences to provide more people with more choices in more places. But our commitment doesn't end there. We are using our resources and energy to make a positive impact on the world. We support the livelihoods of thousands of farmers and retailers. We set the bar in water efficiency and are helping improve access to clean water and reduce our impact on the environment, in our communities and beyond. And we are working hard to ensure every experience with our beer is a positive one, bringing people together through our brands, our people, and our communities, today and for generations to come. We are AB InBev.
So now you know a bit more about who I'm representing and probably why. Let me give you a very quick view into how our company has grown. It's important because this is something we are extremely proud of, and it'll kind of get into why we are doing what we are doing today, why we are starting to look more like a technology company rather than a beer brewing company, and why we are going so big in data science analytics and everything that comes with it. We started as a $60 million company. Three friends chose to buy us for about $60 million in Brazil. And they had a vision that they want to be world's biggest brewers. And today we are $200 billion in our market cap. And all of this has happened in just 30 years. So I want to quickly tell you about what I think was the core reason as to why we have seen this kind of growth. And then I'll dwell into what we are here to talk about today. So series of things that I spoke about, a lot of, Stella comes from Interbrew. We did discuss about Budweiser coming from Anheuser-Busch. Very interesting, 2008 was a recession while people were closing their companies. We are a company who was acquiring somebody who was bigger than us. Interbrew back then was $30 billion in their market cap, and we bought Budweiser for $52 billion. And the surprising part is that some banks chose to give us that money to make that decision. So these are the kind of crazy things we have done in the past, and we have a method as to why we feel very comfortable going after these things time and again. And that kind of gets you to AB InBev, while we also have Corona acquisition somewhere around 2013, 2012. And then Sab Miller was our recent acquisition, which is world's, I think, second biggest deal in all cash, $109 billion acquisition. So why I'm really proud and why I'm choosing to focus, first 10, 15 minutes on about my company is because of two things that I have learned after I've come here. In just last 3 years, I can't believe how associated and how at home I feel with this company. One is what we like to call DPC, Dream, People, and Culture. Unlike other companies or the companies that I have, have some experience with, this company likes to really believe in how we want to do things every day. And each one of these things that are written here are not things written in our walls. I can actually tell you these in my sleep. There are two words explanation to this, a line explanation to this, as it says, and sometimes a page worth explanation on these. The basic idea of this framework is that it takes same amount of energy to dream small, then why dream small? Let's always try to dream big. Every time we think of, I'm just a data scientist and I'm right now trying to solve a forecasting problem, so just let me just look at improving the uplift and be done with that. We actually don't stop there because this is one way of thinking that forces us to keep thinking that is it really solving the final problem that my company is facing? Can I actually, through what access I'll have to resources or to people, influence more than just that? And that's kind of the gist of what we try to do there. People has two principles. We try to recruit people who are better than us. If in an interview we don't find glimpse of some things that the other person can do better than us, nobody can be completely better than other person in all dimensions, right? You always find qualities in different people which actually will connect with you and which will get them attracted towards what they are going to bring to the table. We believe very strongly in that, and most of our interviews are tailored to try to bring out those qualities out of the people that we are hiring. And of course, other thing that we do is always try to focus that one who's doing really well must grow. So we let people grow at the pace of their talent and their hard work rather than their experience. So in our team, we have senior managers who we externally hire with experience of 12, 13 years. And we have a person with 5 years of experience sitting at the same position and has been homegrown through some of the great work that they have done. So those are the kind of things that we believe in. And then there is culture. We believe in many things. We believe in ownership, that people who take complete ownership are actually people who go beyond and do more for themselves and for the causes that they are working for, rather than just trying to do what they are asked to do. We have we never feel satisfied. We like to keep things simple. We lead by example. We don't want to take any shortcuts. We have seen after some acquisitions 17 straight quarters of decline at times. But we have never chose to take a shortcut where you could just bribe a person or do something which is, which is not really ethical for us to get ahead and get on the growing path again. So it takes time. All of these things are, really slow at times. But once you get on those things and, you start to build things for long term. And that brings me to my other point, which is we believe that we are here to stay for 100 plus years, as it says. Right? I don't know if there are any fans of Simon Sinek. He talks about something called, something called infinite game, right? If you want to succeed in just 1 or 2 years, it's not that difficult. We can actually reduce our prices, do some small adjustments, and actually can grow fast enough, especially through the portfolio we have or the reach we have, the global footprint that we have. But if you want to sustain yourself for 100 years, you need to think as to how will I continuously grow, 5%, 6%, or whatever I can sustain. What is that right rate, and what can I do with that kind of growth? Just like that, our sustainability goal, better known as CSR for many other companies, are nothing but things where we feel that we have to invest. We don't want to just do it as a CSR. It's actually something that we have chose to make our business itself, right? So let me tell you. So how our CEO puts it is that beer is not a business which is like an iPhone or Apple kind of business, right? You can manufacture a lot of phones in China and then you can ship it somewhere else and then you are good and you start selling. That's not how it works. Beer is usually a community-driven business. We have breweries, we have supply around that area, we take water from the community, we have people who are probably working in our breweries from those community and sometimes are consuming right there and then. So it's a very community-led business, and that's why you have to feel more responsible for the kind of things that you're going to do, what kind of impact you're going to leave on planet or on societies than anything else. So we have a lot of these programs like circular packaging. By the way, we keep doing hackathons or some of these other topics and then analytics-led or sometimes just smart design-led solutions end up being the winning solutions that we continue to implement. So circular packaging, for example, is one where we'll not leave any plastic that we generate on the streets. It will never end up in any capacity in places where it can get into a issue of not being recycled and hence leaving an impact. And we have some goals around all of these, but I'll leave you with just these thoughts for now. So why are we here today? The basic idea that I want to talk about with you guys is, it's really important that we have to, start to upskill ourselves and apply analytics, and there's so many things that are going on. But there is a parallel thread. Sometimes, at least in some situations, a more important thread that you have to stay, really glued to, which is how will you work with people? How will you, manage your stakeholders, or how will you keep winning with them in terms of proving it to them time and again that you are a value add every time you are on the same table with them, right? So putting this in context, we are a company as now with some of this history, you understand, it's not a digitally born company, right? We have breweries which are in remote corners of the world. We brew beer, we had ledgers and so on to maintain things for years together. And suddenly we have a big desire now to be digital. You guys will not believe the amount of CapEx investments that we are making to ensure that we get onto this really fast. And there are also companies on the digital side of the world which are trying to become more and more brick and mortar, right? Amazon is trying to, have its own special experiential, retail stores. They are acquiring companies like Whole Foods. So there is a lot that everybody is doing because there is value in doing both. Lucky for us, although it seems very simple that we can just have an app and now we are digital and things can change, it's not as easy. There's a fair bit of change management because it's not just us. it's people who buy from us and all of them, they also are you know, bit behind. And I'm talking about our POC owners, people who sell our beer to consumers like you guys. So there is, it is a journey, but we have a better shot, we believe, at doing this, because we don't have to go and open stores or find land or build buildings and so on, right? We have to build codes, we have to build algorithms, and we have a shot of learning from everybody who has already done something in this space. So we really have a unique opportunity that, so I don't know if most of you have seen or visited Singapore or, so I've visited London and Singapore, and I think Singapore has just blatantly copied a lot of things from London as a city. You know, the way people will cross road, and you know, the way underpasses will be marked and so on. And then you start to see that actually they have done a lot more with it. You know, a country or a city that was the first mover had just their imagination. Person who moves second sometimes have that, plus whatever else that they can bring to the table. Right? So we feel that we have a serious shot and making this really big, and our plan and our investments are something that is unbelievable for you know, anybody to think about. And this actually takes us not just to analytics. So I want to first start with the overall landscape that we are dealing with, and then start to zoom into what we are doing with analytics and what is going on there. But you know, we are hiring a series of different profiles which we have never hired before. So we have a lot of data engineers already in the company. We have Scrum Masters. We have, of course, data scientists is something we started hiring 3 years ago when I joined. And you know, that's why our company and the profiles or the talent that we have to manage in the company is also rapidly evolving. And our people team, what we like to call our HR team, is doing a phenomenal job of accommodating all of these things together. Right? But this brings us to what are we doing in analytics space, and then let's get into how we feel that we can win or succeed time and again when you're working in analytics with your stakeholders. So it's a small video talking about some of what we have achieved so far, and this is our office in right next door to UB City. So most of that is from our growth analytics center. We have two more offices in Bangalore. One is the India business unit. We call it India BU. And then another one is called GCC, Global Capability Center, where again we have started a huge, have started with a huge team that focuses on data engineering and data science. Let's talk briefly about how GAC has grown and what we are doing in analytics. So we have about 130 odd people today on our payroll here in GAC office, plus part of that team sits in GCC. But then we have what you also probably noticed, the logo called ABI Analytics, which is what we go by when we involve everybody who's doing analytics globally with us. That clocks to about 300, 350 odd people. But it's a team that is growing really fast. That those number of people doing analytics to change lives or change processes for 180,000 people that we are is something that we still have a lot to do for. So we started with doing single projects. We had three projects with which my boss came to India. He's a Brazilian, came to India, tried solving three independent problems, very disconnected from each other. Those siloed projects started growing, and you know, we started seeing that the outcomes of one connect with other, so things should pick up and, you know, start to build capabilities, and that started to happen. And now we are getting into a place where we're connecting all the capabilities. So if you saw, we started with just revenue management, which is like a sales strategy function, as the area where we applied analytics, and now we have grown into marketing, people analytics, supply and logistic, name you, operations. So we've gotten into so many other spaces, and we are seeing a lot of impact. And you know, you touch anything in operations, and you see millions worth of impact just because the size of our business looks like that. So what we are eventually moving from a push-based system to pull, and that is what we peg all our success on, right? We actually first used to create, solve things with analytics, and then we used to try to sell it. And now we have started to get into a place where we ask as to what solutions do we need and what we can actually help you with. This is one area where, being in service industry, I have seen myself also fail many times in the past, that we always try to think that, these are the four solutions I have, let me see what their problem is, and I keep hearing, and by the time client gets to a point that, I have a solution for this. You know, you always work to what you already have, rather than keeping an open mind that, you know what, this time I'm gonna learn more than the guy who's you know, trying to hire me internally, in our case. So winning with stakeholders becomes really relevant in that case, right? So pull is not generated in a day. It takes a lot of time, a lot of effort. I will quote some examples which will try to give you a view of what kind of work we are doing along the way. But I want to share with you seven key principles that we have applied to you know, get to a journey from push to a pull. We really focused about learning about each other's world. So everything, almost everything I'm going to say is really a two-way exercise. You don't just do things for stakeholder or give it to them. You actually also get it back in return just with a lag, right? So, and we'll talk about that as well. You have to empathize with your stakeholder. We'll talk about that as well. Establish ways of working that are sustainable. Doing something one time, two time, for a month actually doesn't work. You really need to think long-term and set up things accordingly. Don't get too emotional about your part. I'll explain that later bit better. Be ready to make a data science compromise. Over-communicate till you reach an equilibrium. You have to communicate a lot. And be authentic and constructive in your retros. So feedback sessions or retros in agile lingo. What we mean when you talk about learn about each other's world is that you have to genuinely take interest in business. I have worked with a lot of people who just come to me and say that, you know, we want to learn business, and then, you know, they start to feel, I kind of understand this, and, you know, they start to lose interest after a month and a half into the journey. That's not how it works. If you see how we have, you know, studied in our life, it took a lot of years to get to a place where we actually started to understand and see things. I don't know if we have some Matrix fans here. You know, you stop to see the code, you see the Matrix. And that happens if you keep trying and keep, you know, looking at the same thing over and over again from different lenses, because business does that. And we sometimes want an injection. We want to learn Python in 2 weeks and then R in the following week, and then we want to just start coding to solve the world's problem. That sometimes is something that we have to be more patient with, right? Showcase your strengths. You know, it's not always about just trying to understand what business does. It's also about telling them as to what you want or you bring to the table additionally, and be really dependable. Like, you know, they should be able to feel that you are bringing something to the table that really matters, and you try to give them that, in as authentic capacity as you can. So When you're talking about something like understanding each other's world, I have examples from the past that actually connect really well. Right? So I have done two roles. In 3 years of being in AB InBev, I have done four different roles. And in two roles, I was faced with very different kind of challenges. One was about setting up a team on operations analytics that they'll try to do things around, lot of work around NLP, we used to get a lot of invoices where you will, try to apply OpenCV. I think the person who was speaking before me was talking a lot about that. So we do all of those kind of things a lot in this space, because you just have a lot of data and you just need to make some sense out of it quickly enough so that it can start to show as an impact in your bottom line. And in that case, when I went to a different office, the GCC office, the third office that we have, I sat in that office and people were just open. They knew, because they've been reading newspapers and hearing other people talk, that analytics can change the world. They just wanted something to tell them how. And they would say yes to almost anything I'll tell them, right? So sometimes you have to lead your stakeholder, be confident. Sometimes you won't know enough about their business, but the situation will present to you as that they're gonna follow you no matter what you have to say, or what no matter how mundane or small that thing for you is, it actually can be very big for somebody else. And right after that, I took a role where we had CSO who has commissioned a project where we are calculating elasticities for our project on a global scale. So it was a sales special project last year. And in that, for first 5 or 6 months, I just kept my mouth shut, because I was traveling to MIT and GHQ, which is New York for us, every 2 weeks, 1 week in MIT, 1 week in GHQ, and 2 weeks here. That was my month, and I did that for about 6 months in 2019 first half. And for first 5 months, I didn't have anything to contribute, because there was so much to learn. When we went to MIT, there were professors who were talking about how these elasticities are calculated now. World has evolved. We're not doing Rotterdam anymore. We are not doing those models which used to work. They have moved to BLP. Nevo's paper is something that they keep talking about. AIDS, almost identical demand system is another thing that we have worked a lot with. In just one area like discrete choice modeling, we have actually gone through different lenses of how a specific problem can be solved, an age-old problem, because we've been in this business forever, right? So those are the kind of partnerships we have with likes of MIT, and it was important in this project for them to be involved. And at the same time, we were working with a consultant who was in GHQ with us very often, and we were learning through them as to what is more practical. How on the ground some of these pricing principles translate. Maybe log actually does the job, so why should I get involved in all of this complex stuff, right? So be more practical, and which only comes if you are ready to listen, if you are ready to willing to just absorb and continue to see that, have you actually understood business as well as the other person on the table who's representing business? Because if not, and if you find this gap to be too wide, in those situations, it's better to just, say that I don't understand, and then keep learning till the time you do. So you really need to understand the, where you're operating, from operations analytics to this, Project Spring, as we called it. I faced with a lot of, very different scenarios, and I actually adapted to be successful at both. The other thing is really important, which is something that I have learned by being in where my stakeholder is multiple times over the last few years. You need to start empathizing with people, because they are human too, right? Your stakeholders are human too. I work with a person who's a Latin American, settled in US. His wife doesn't speak English, actually didn't do when they moved there. He faces a lot of difficulties as well. We always feel that, our day is the worst. I travel 1.5 hours one way in my cab to get to my office. It's not a good life. My back hurts. all those problems actually exist with your stakeholders as well, right? In fact, if I tell you, you know, the day about this person that I'm talking about, you know, they get up at 4:30. They have to leave their home by 6. They don't have any maids or help at home, so they have to do bulk of their work by themselves. And if, you know, if the wife can't speak English, for this person, life gets really difficult because he has to be there to do some of those things for her, you know, which ideally, you know, another adult should be able to take care of on your behalf. And then there is office, in which India is waiting for overlap. India has a lot of questions. India has to send this, that. And then, you know, their day starts with just India blocking first 2-3 hours. And I'm taking an example from US here, which is why. And then that overlap sometimes reduces. That makes it even tougher because in that gap, you have to explain so much and sometimes you're not able to. And then their day really starts. When I've sat next to them, I've realized how difficult their day is because being in global, at times you have to stay connected with so many people to form that view that global has to have. Constantly talking to zones, sometimes to countries or BUs, as we call them, to have the picture that is required to, you know, keep running the show from global. And then there comes the pressure. They have the money. Hence, they have the pressure of making decisions and pressure of, you know, delivering some things which are hard numbers in terms of dollar impact or in terms of, you know, percentage increases or uplifts. And then they get home, again, taking an R15 or R20 minutes train, which isn't very different from what we also do. So by being there many times, this is what I have realized, that, you know, sometimes we just start to feel very early on as to what, you know, what are my problems, and we get in this space and where we start to give up very easily. To counter this, at least in my previous organization, we had done something called a virtual team day, where we had booked a series of meeting rooms, you know, and, you know, 2 months in advance, and then we had a core main room where we were doing this virtual off-site of a sort, where we had activities, games planned, and then people will break out in other meeting rooms on both sides to have one-on-one conversations or two-on-two conversations and so on to complete tasks, activity. People actually, you know, introduce each other, right? You know, if a person is sitting here, there's somebody else from there who will introduce them with something more personal and all. So we forced some kind of interactions that started to build that empathy that is really required. You have to care personally. You have to actually get involved in a way where, you know, they start to feel that you are in it with them, and then, you know, you really care for them at all levels. Establish right ways of working, really important. If you don't start with that big picture mentality, if you don't really start with doing what is right the first time, it's going to take a hit on you. So I know a person who works very, very hard. And it actually, you know, it really works out well for us because most of the times you get a turnaround of a day with them and, you know, things are solved so quickly. But he chooses to work every day till 3 a.m. Right? Now, that actually does a lot of good to GHQ, but it doesn't do a lot of good to his own team because they don't want to work for that long. Right? And these ways of working actually then set expectations which aren't right. When this person left that role and somebody else replaced them, it became really difficult because that person couldn't deliver what the other person previously was very easily delivering, right? They just were comfortable working 11 a.m. to 3 a.m. And that isn't the way everybody would want to work. So it's really important that, you know, whatever you think about, it has to be broadly sustainable. If you just think about things which are for a week or 2 weeks or a month, you're going to miss the bigger picture, and hence you will not be able to sustain them and will lead to these kind of challenges. Don't get too attached to your work. So this is something which is really important and I think is very specific, you know, is a bigger problem for folks in analytics, in my opinion. The challenge is, more often than not, your stakeholder doesn't understand what you are doing, right? You actually have just run a gradient boost, and now it's a bit hard to explain it to layman who actually doesn't have the time or the basic foundation to grasp the concept as to what's happening there. in those cases, what really starts to happen is people actually, have disconnects, and then, you are not understanding what other person is trying to say, and then you start to fall apart. What I have at least come to realize is it's really important to let go what we think is the right or the only way. Right? Sometimes just trying to understand what stakeholder is saying will actually help you understand that what you are saying is probably one of the options. There are many other ways of solving it, and maybe their way is better. Right? It only comes by doing step one and two really well, because you then have that bond through which you can operate at this level. Here, I have some example where I have personally worked with somebody who used to be a client line manager, and I used to be the analytics lead. We used to come together to deliver to our clients in a setup that I have worked in. The thing there was is that I worked for almost 2 weeks straight, day and night, two other people with me. We had done a lot of work, a lot of analysis. This was the first meeting we were going to have with the CMO of this company. We fly into the place after 2 weeks. We have about 15 odd slides. We're very comfortable with what we have gotten to, insights and so on. And then this person that I work with, Kara, she has a conversation with one of the admins, the person who was actually running the agenda and so on, and she ended up talking to them over coffee, and she asked them that what's going on, how are things moving, and she ended up realizing that somebody else is gonna take the CEO position in that company was about to change, and she asked that who's likely to go with this, and she understood as to who the person is. They used to run a huge thread on multi-channel for the company. So they used to run an omni-channel strategy for the company. And she came back to me and she asked me some questions that, do you know enough about multi-channel? Do we have data to say something about that? Can we have a point of view? I said, yeah, sure. And I showed her a thing or two, and then, she asked me more questions, and then in about hour and a half that we had, we actually came up with some points which were good insights to land, just to get somebody interested. And then I see her final deck when we start presenting to CMO and this other person who was gonna be CEO, that of the 15 slides we had, we just have 5, and then we have 4 new slides which are all about multi-channel. I felt really bad that I worked so hard on those things. It was many nights on those 2 weeks that we spent to get to those slides, and we so easily she just moved it to that. And then I realized sitting in that meeting that those 5 slides actually went through very fast. And there were some questions and there were some aha moments. But when things got to multi-channel, actually they started getting really engaged. There were a lot of questions. There was a lot of dialogue. They started building a plan which was for far out. So what I realized is, she actually had a very good knack for understanding as to what problem to solve or what topic to talk about. So it's not sometimes really about what you're too emotional about, because I have done this or because I know this is right, or you have no idea, this is the best R-square I've gotten in my life. All of those things actually don't seem to matter, because the other person is trying to solve a problem which you haven't really paid attention to. And that's what she could see really well. So I tried a lot to learn this from her thereafter. That very evening, she got another 101 with that person, where we won another contract, which was even bigger than the one we were there for to start with. So there have been these instances which have actually been milestone for me to actually start to realize some of the things that you really need to be thinking about when you're working with somebody else. And then comes the data science compromise. Now, by saying this, I don't really mean that you don't have to do the right thing, or you shouldn't worry about metrics or KPIs that are important to prove success of your models and so on. But all I'm trying to say is that there is a right algorithm or a right combination that should work. It doesn't always have to be the most complicated or the best solution, or the first algorithm that you chose to go all the way down like a rabbit hole to is the only answer, right? When you start to keep an open mind and when you start to think about what the right algorithm is, you will start to realize that stakeholder kind of understands. So the example that I was talking about previously, we actually ended up doing full circle on a project, you know, where we started in the family of discrete choice modeling by doing multinomial logit, then we went to a nested logit, then we went to almost identical demand system, and then we implemented BLP, and then we came full circle back to log what we already had. Why? Because even, you know, some of these best algorithms in this space weren't actually giving numbers which made sense. You could see data and you could simulate some of those things like our stakeholders normally do. They do spot checks most of the times, and they have strong hunches over these spot checks. But sometimes their hunches are strong enough because the person that we are working with here has spent 23 years working in just this space, thinking about this day and night, and then they see one data point and they can tell that it's wrong because I know this. So these are the kind of things that we have come to realize, that sometimes you go so far down in an algorithm, you know, because we actually started working on this with MIT, and then, you know, unfortunately, sometimes academic partnership can be a bit divergent, right? Oh, to do this, there are 5 methods. And to do these 5 things, there are 3 methods each. And now you have 15, 20 options where you're struggling as to, okay, so which one is my solution, really? Right? Because stakeholders wants to be convergent. They want to understand what will solve their problem rather than going on getting more and more and more options, which are actually complicating things. So which is why we have actually chosen to taper that partnership in a way where it actually starts to be convergent. And hence, we started developing something which we called Flex model, which was actually part gut, part information that we had basis all of these experiments, and we combined that to put a solution. And why do we have to do that? Like, you know, because in real world, there are timelines that will actually, you know, make you miss the boat completely. If we did not change the price on a given time, the regulations will change. Or if I did not give discounts on a, you know, at a particular time, competition is gonna take all the points that you know I was trying to get. So it gets very difficult to balance some of those things, and if you start to appreciate your stakeholder more and more, you will realize why you need to do this. I'm not by any means saying that you don't do the best thing possible. You always should, but you need to time it well, or you need to set aside your capacity to do so, or you need to have a pre-alignment like we had, that for 3 months blank, we just went in circles and it was absolutely fine. Because it was pre-aligned with stakeholders, it was funded, we had a partnership where somebody very credible from MIT was actually supporting us, right? And then over-communicate. I mean, this is very easy. If you don't communicate, it becomes a problem. If you have that foundation, if you have all of those things that we spoke about, it gets easier, because even if you miss a communication or two, people still understand where you're coming from, how you think, or what you would have done already, even though you have not told me so. But it actually still is very important to close the loop, is what at least I have come to realize. There is a person who has worked very closely with me, is the hardest working person I know. And you know, they're up all night, many hours, never missed a single feedback, never missed a task that was given to them, but fails to actually just inform other person that this is done or is in this state. I'm doing all of these 20 things you asked me to do. And you know, what that continues to do is that you continue to have a situation where you don't have the information that you must have had with that person by a certain time. So extremely important when it comes to stakeholder management. And lastly, be super authentic. Be very constructive. You know, this is something that I realized in that project by working 6 months and staying quiet for most of it. It's hard to believe with me that I can stay quiet for 6 months. But once I had a lot of feelings and a lot of, you know, things that I wanted to say because I didn't feel right about certain things, the way they were done, or, you know, we were quickly ignoring some things, or some things were not implemented the way I actually thought that, you know, doing proper due diligence, they you know, given this data and so on, this is how it should be. But you know, there were actually no times when I could say some of those things, and hence I kept procrastinating some of these things, which I ideally is not the best idea. You have a problem, because you have the foundation of trust, you say it, right? You will be better off. First couple of these communications will be very uncomfortable, but then it starts to get better, and then you start to get to a place where you talk openly all the time, and there's no problem. It takes 5-6 months, about the time that I spent, right? And then you always have to make sure that you're respectful, but never, almost never hide anything that you ever felt. Best to say it right then. We almost make it a point to, with every project that we close, I don't know if you guys are okay with retro lingo, that, you know, after every sprint, you should look back and see what you could do differently and so on. But at least at the end of the project, you must always do this, because that is when people are most open. If that project is successful, they will actually take all your feedback very easily. So that's your chance. So get in there. So on that note, I'll just say that I know that I did not, I know this convention is about machine learning. I know I did not speak a lot about some of those things. Those are some of the things that we are all about when you get into our offices or what we are doing, the projects that we are working on, the problems that we are solving. But I felt it was also important to share another aspect that was really critical, which is staying on top of how these projects will become successful. In our evolving world, where stakeholder thinks that they already know data science, but sometimes they don't, it gets all the more important to tell them as to what are the things that they don't really understand still, and I will bring to the table, so trust me on that. And that comes by doing some of the things that we just discussed. So on that note, I'd just like to take a leave and thank you for your time and interest. Any questions, if you may have? Yeah. So my name is Yes. 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 So basically we have different projects which are in different cycles of maturity, I would like to say. Some are such where it's not really possible to run it as an agile project, because you don't you have the biggest challenge, your stakeholder is not trained on some of these things. They don't understand, why daily? I'll meet you, you know, once in 3 days, 2 days, whatever works for them. So it gets little difficult to execute, and hence we still have those projects that run the way they would run, especially on the front. But at the back, at least, we have our daily stand-ups. If we have to keep it, so what we do is we get the product owner on this side of the, you know, border, and then we say, okay, our product owner is an internal person and they will run the project, because they will translate what the stakeholder wants on a daily basis, right? So we do that a little bit, but we're not very successful there. But there are very clear projects where we are doing almost product development. So what we are quickly getting into, and our last whole year was about thinking about this, that how should we get analytics into platforms that we have? Good thing is we are part of the solutions vertical, which is what we like to call our technology that other companies would call. We have 10 different verticals, of which analytics is one. So data is another, for example, business transformation is another, and so on. So there are other verticals like delivery, which will actually build apps, build websites, you know, build products for internal use and so on. We have those kind of things which are also being done. And now we are always talking about analytics, if created and if is making sense, should actually land there instead of in the hands of a stakeholder through Excel files and so on, right? So we are very quickly getting into a place where everything is platform driven, and that needs a lot of discipline, because now you're working with people who actually have always worked like this for a long time, So yes, we, most of us are already trained on Scrum and Agile. We do have Scrum Masters in all the situations where we are almost dealing with. We have a big assortment tool which we have built with North America that is influencing, you know, almost 15,000 sales reps, you know, daily agenda. So that's how big the scope is, and that's how powerful that app now is. And some of those things really demand for us to push versions properly, and then, you know, you cannot be in production, you have to do things in development. So all of those disciplines have cracked. Is that what you were?
Yeah, I have a question here. So, see, this is a change that you're talking about. You're bringing analytics or any of these things across. It's like a change agent that you're acting across to bring a transformation. Now, there is a leadership which wants to change across, top leadership, right? As a vision, they want to change, but they themselves as individual don't want to change. I need my reports in Excel only the way that I'm used to getting them or in the emails. Now, this kind of a typical, as a change agent or as a transformation lead, you would find that. And since your topic covers more about the soft skills and how do we take them ahead. On the flip side, you have a workforce which is, you know, fearful of the command and control kind of a leadership which is existing out there. Now, how have you tackled this kind of a scenario? You are expected to bring a change in the organization which is effective, but don't ask me to change across. And don't ask any of the things that I execute to have a command in my leadership to get change across. So how do you bring that transformation within that journey to with the soft skills that you're telling across?
This is brilliant. So I mean, of course, opening GAC itself was a sign that we want to get serious about analytics now, right? It's about time we have data. So lucky for us, I don't know, I know it company to company, it can vary a lot and some people just won't change and becomes a problem. But in our company, most of the leaders have always been very data driven, right? So even if they don't understand, analytics or how this data now is morphed into this distribution to get that, they don't understand all of that, but they've been very data-driven. They look at data, they will follow trends, and then mentally, whatever they could make out of it, they will. They'll always quote those things. So there was nobody who was coming to table for a very long time when I spoke to these stakeholders who would not give me logic of what they actually said it won't work. They are actually very fierce in our company, and that's why I spoke about the culture, because people are actually, when we say owners, people start to take it very personally that, man, it's my problem, this is my agenda, I will control it. So that actually brings a very, good debate. So when we opened GAC, everybody understood that, just being data-driven isn't enough. We have to be analytics-driven as well. But it did not change a thing about those stakeholders who are talking about. When we were in, mid of our second year, that's when we started to get very serious about education. We said that analytics, if you don't give education to people, if you don't help them see what about their day has to change or what about their life will change should they comply with this, they will not follow the suit. But how we went about doing that is we took almost half of 2018 going to different zones, attracting middle management. That first you need to understand what does your day look like. You know what? These three things you could do like this. We already have something here to plug in. And that's how we started transforming one zone at a time, one team at a time, and middle management first. Because when these people started to do things, talking to the senior person and saying, you know what, your guy is already doing this and you can just talk to them. And they started presenting more things than they otherwise would in the same amount of time, started to slowly change that mindset. So I'll be lying if I say everybody in AB InBev now just does this, but there are very important key people in GHQ who have now started to realize that, or actually had somewhat of this mindset, but they did not have time to actually go about doing this by themselves. So a lot of people have welcomed the analytics and this talent in the company and hence are partnering and sponsoring, while some others need this subtle way of driving this transformation. There was an article on this as well, that our CEO set aside 7 days last year to actually go through 7 different courses which were all about technology. Okay. And there were professors and startups who designed those courses for him. And after that, he said that, I just want to challenge you guys more. You're bringing these new things to me. I feel uncomfortable. He doesn't feel good about that. So he did that, and then he had all chiefs go through this. And there was also another force, which is more technology-focused rather than analytics-focused. We have taken the baton for analytics, and we were going about it like this. Sorry. He has the mic, so.
Okay, one second. What is the, when you mentioned the platform in which you're
No, it is. These are. So, for example, we have certain B2B solutions, which are apps, websites, where we have recently worked with two important zones where we have solutions deployed to give live recommendations. So the entire recommender system that is working on that is actually feeding off the data that is coming through the app, processing and creating APIs, which are then again being pulled back by the app to recommend, to those POCs. POCs are nothing but pubs, bars, restaurants who are selling our products. So basically, we are enabling POCs through platforms to actually directly talk there and then get recommendation. So this is just one example of how we are using analytics to kind of go back to the same platform, which is serving some other purposes. So it's not a BI tool. There are some where we said, okay, you know what? Everybody needs to see how are our sales in terms of volume and net revenue. So hence, we should have a common reporting management system. We've crossed that like even before we started with analytics. So we are past that for sure. But now it's about actually being in the platform that is in the hands of people where the data is being created. Makes sense? Sorry.
So while we are working on something, for example, like any project or any task, we are sometimes not sure of what the ETA will be. So even that kind of takes a backstep, like we are not very confident in communicating by when we will get that over. So where you quoted an example of there's a guy who works very hard but does not communicate. So what, according to you, is the right way to communicate? Like give an ETA or tell like you're not sure of the ETA, or how do you over-communicate, basically?
I think the answer...
Yeah, you don't know, when you're not sure what you're going to work. Yeah.
I mean, experimentation will probably run slightly differently, but I'll give you the answer to this lies in the Scrum or Agile framework. You don't want to give the whole fruit. You just want to give a whole slice. But you just don't give, parts of slice, because that doesn't work. If you start to show any stakeholder, see, again, this is the part that I really realize every time I sit with them and I try to work with my team also remotely, and I start to feel this, that, it's quite difficult. Your stakeholder just needs to feel secure that I've asked somebody to do something which is only going to be solved with analytics, which I don't understand enough about, but if it doesn't come in time, how am I going to make this decision? They just need to feel secure. Rather than having them work on, with their own plan B and so on, you have a chance to take control while you start showing what is already complete. If you have EDA with some insights while you have still not started your model, I would suggest you share, right? And you share with it's low priority, just read, and this is just for you to understand that we are making progress. They just need to see that you are going to be able to get there, and that security only comes if they start to see movement. Sometimes if you have done 3 projects with them, now in 4th they have already that trust where you don't need to do it. But when you are doing it for the first time, you really must do that. And in case of experimentation, you need to have a pre-alignment. We did not experiment till the time we delivered one cycle of whatever garbage we had to create, because we didn't have the right time to actually go through everything that the way we wanted. Scope was too large, and there were too many people, like I said, a consultant, MIT, us, stakeholders themselves. But then we actually won the credibility to do an exploration study, and hence they were open.
Then they will be able to understand if the hypothesis that you are building, is it really correct or not? Because that's where the domain comes in.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that is part of understanding their world. Because if you start to see as to what they are saying and why they are saying it, and it will be very mundane. It isn't, price is net revenue divided by volume. It's not. there's a lot more to it. And that you get, I mean, that is why I was talking to, I think Sonal, my colleague here is sitting here, and we were having this conversation that she's done a PhD from ISI. And, you know, in PhD, you're talking about something so small for 5 long years. Why? Because after first year, when you've gone over all the obvious stuff, in second year, in third year, then you start to see things which were not visible earlier. And that's what is the right lens to learn about business, in my opinion, at least.